Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this new version of Leading Through the Pandemic. I am the help of IIM Mumbai. And best wishes to all of you for Ganesh Chaturthi as well. Just realized that Ganesh Chaturthi as well. Hope you are all doing very well and keeping safe. My name is Ajay Agarwal. I head retail in Neyland, as well as I'm part of 100 Watts. 100 Watts is an industry initiative to nurture technology in retail through startup ecosystem. Retail has gone through a very, very tough 5 months, and we are really now, we're trying to live back to normalcy and recovery path, hopefully. As a tech practitioner, I feel that I'm very optimistic, and I feel this is an opportunity for the industry to ramp up its digital roadmap and not just bring efficiency and agility into the business, but also re-engage with the customers, suppliers, and maybe other partners, employees, in a much more meaningful and much more efficient manner. Will it happen? I'm not sure, but I'm very hopeful. Retail future fast forward, that is the theme given by our guest today. We have very eminent retail personality with us, Biju Kurian, member of strategy board, L. Cutterton Asia, and former president, Reliance Retail. I've been seeing Biju all through my retail career in various roles, across the industry. And I've learned a lot while listening to him, engaging with him whenever I got a chance to do that. Welcome to Leading Through Pandemic, Biju. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you, Ajay.
So let me begin asking you, we were just talking about briefly, can you tell us, I believe you are very, very passionately involved in this meal distribution and food distribution during the lockdown. That's the beginning of the lockdown. And then we'll come down to, then I would like to know from you, what do you think retail will come back or to what it was, or will it be different? And what is your opinion, quickly, your opening thoughts?
Sure. Just maybe a few words about, thank you, Ajay, and happy Gauri Ganesh to all of the people who are on this call. Just to maybe share a few moments on the meal distribution. It wasn't really meal distribution, because in the beginning, a group of us got together maybe a day or two after the first lockdown was announced on the 25th of March and said that, we have around us various kinds of people who probably don't have the same privileges that we have. And is there a way in which we can reach out and assist? Funnily enough, this group was under the aegis of what you might define as the XLRI, Excel, which is the Management Institute, the Alumni Association, the Bangalore chapter to which I belong. And then we said that, okay, fine, let's try and do something. And we had no clue where to start. So the first thing we said is, should we give them, meals, or should we give them food? And we said, well, essentially the end purpose is the same, but there are two different ways. It's easier to give people rice and wheat and sugar and oil and a few, vegetables like potatoes and onions and dal, versus say giving them breakfast, lunch and dinner, because the logistics and the challenges around the two are very different, and also the coverage can be more. Second part is, who do we actually identify as the needy people? And we said that the most neediest people are those who are dependent on daily incomes, those who are not from this particular state or city, and those who actually the next day, the day the lockdown happened, would be deprived of an income, and at the bottom end in terms of the socioeconomic category. So we went around identifying a whole bunch of blue-tented, when I say blue-tented, what I'm saying is the blue plastic sheet-tented accommodation kind of people who live there, very much at what you might define as the margins, and then work through NGOs to be able to make sure that we actually got to distribute dry rations to a lot of them. Lots of challenges along the way. We had political involvement. We had the local cooperators coming in and trying to muscle in into this entire thing. They wanted to corner it and give it to their people. And, we had to then try and beat that. We had to use the police sometimes to come in there to be able to help distribute, the logistics of managing it, right from, getting lorries to be able to transport rice and wheat from the mandis and from, metro and Arvind really helped in the beginning, Big Basket, and Hari also really helped in the beginning to be able to help us source some of these things. But, you know, simple things like, say, a poly bag, a twine, these kind of things weren't available because shops are closed. But it was a great, great learning experience. Anyway, now switching back to whether you think the retail will be the same. And I think the first-hand experience I got, and a lot of us got during that meal distribution effort, gave us a great understanding of how companies and consumers can actually change their behavior during, you know, really painful situations. If you look at it from a retailer's perspective, retailers were forced to close down because either they couldn't access the goods that they wanted because of, you know, transport shutdowns, or the mandis were shut down, etc. In many cases, they work with migrant labor, so the employees migrated. They went back to their hometowns, or they were shuttered down and they didn't have local transport to be able to come, so because of which they couldn't even open a store. Many of them were in what you might define as closure or containment zones, because of which they also couldn't open a store. Several of their suppliers, including the large FMCG companies, they were also forced to close down. They were forced to close down because there was a paucity of raw materials. They couldn't actually get raw materials to come in. They didn't have transport because, you remember, the first week to 10 days, all trucks, wherever they were, whatever movement stage they were actually closed at the borders. So they needn't have transport to be able to get the raw materials to their places. And with the stores closed, they didn't even know. Distributors are closed, stores are closed, wholesalers are closed. They didn't even know how much should be made. So even manufacturers were actually in a situation where they were actually forced to close down. A lot of companies, and these were, you know, what we might define as the top creamy layer of Indian employment categories, which is roughly about 20% of our total employee strength, work in these kind of companies. These companies closed down their offices, and they closed down because of the regulatory norms which are there due to the health concerns. Employees were also afraid of actually contracting the disease, and so they actually stayed away from the offices, and they were encouraged to do so both by government regulation as well as many companies also put in the same regulation. If you thought that it is only confined to that, you know, the government went ahead and said that any place which has congregations, which are, you know, public spaces such as parks and auditoriums and sporting facilities and malls and theaters and restaurants, a lot of these are also closed down. And then, of course, you know, to add insult to injury, what did happen was that, you know, transportation got closed, local transportation, interstate movement of, let's say, flights and trains and both domestic as well as international travel in terms of flights. A part of the government machinery also closed down. You know, so government offices weren't open. Access to many of the executive and the judicial services. So if you wanted to go to a government office and even seek permission, even for us, I remember during that time to get something called a COVID pass, which enabled people to move around without worry. Even that was, you know, a struggle to find who's the right person to give and to go and to be able to find the right office. So why I'm dwelling on all of this is because I think we need to understand the background through which we have actually gone and continue to go through. And from that background, there are certain lessons that we've learned. And from the lessons that we've learned, we've got to understand what the implications in retail are, and which is why I'm actually taking a little time to be able to, you know, to dwell on a lot of the background. Now, we know that, you know, this closure actually went on for almost 90 days in most places and continues to go down even for most other things. For most other states, many other states, this closure in some form or the other is continuing to extend. Now, the question is that during this 90/120/150 days that we have so far started from the 25th of March, wouldn't our behavior have changed? Now, what we know is psychological studies tell us that on the average, it takes about 66 days for you to be able to create a new habit. Well, it varies. If your habit is, let's say, very addictive, like, say, smoking, it might take longer for you to get out of that habit. If your habit is, you know, not very addictive, then it might take even lesser time. So the range is anywhere from about 20 days to about 250 days in terms of how long does it take to form a habit, whether it's addictive or non-addictive. Now, when we think of it from a consumer perspective, think of consumers having actually spent the last 3 to 4 months in a certain kind of behavior pattern. Wouldn't they have had the opportunity to be able to form a new habit? Now, whether it is addictive or not addictive, it's just a matter of time which will actually tell us. But one of the things that we should remember is that in our brain, there is something which we define as the emotional cortex. Or for the, you know, for to give you a technical word, it's called the amygdala. Now, this is something which is in every hemisphere of our brain and actually determines the emotional responses that we create. So even when we say instinctively, I did this at the time of, let's say, an accident or when my child was hurt, it is because of this emotional cortex which actually drives our body, drives our behavior, which is actually very, very deep-rooted. So if you're told constantly that if you go out, if you touch something, it will harm you, what happens is that you stop doing it. And you stop doing it to the extent that you actually get fearful of actually going out and doing something like this. And over time, what happens is that this fear actually becomes a habit. You know, I know of several people who haven't even stepped out of their homes ever since lockdown one happened. And they're proud of the fact that they have actually not exposed themselves to anything. They said, we haven't stepped out of our homes and actually we haven't got anybody to come into our homes also for the last 4 to 5 months. Now, this can, you know, it sounds very, very depressive. And if you really look at it, these kind of things can actually cause depressive behaviors, and we are seeing a lot of this. But this pandemic is certainly not the scale at which things have happened in the past. And I think a lot of what is also driving this fear is the fact that a lot is getting amplified by social media. Yeah. We had something called swine flu about 10 or 11 years back, and that swine flu actually affected close to about 2 billion people. Okay? This pandemic has affected about 23 million at the last count. That killed about 200,000 people. This has actually killed more people than the swine flu. But even if that affected 2 billion people, we didn't go into the kind of frenzy during swine flu like the way we're going into frenzy now. And that is because everybody and his aunt and uncle is today spreading news on social media, whether it's fake or real, about the kind of fear that we should be having because of what is going to be, what is happening around us and what is going to happen also. So are we victims of this fear? You know, just to share a simple example, in the month of February, there was a rumor spread on WhatsApp saying that if you eat chicken, then you are likely to contract coronavirus. And that industry took 2 months to recover from it, and in the process lost 10,000 crores. The price of chicken dropped from about, you know, farm gate prices of about 80 rupees a kilo for a live bird, went all the way down to 10 rupees a kilo. Wow. And many farmers actually committed suicide because they realized they'd be actually losing a hell of a lot of money. Many people decided it is easier for us to cull a bird rather than to sell a bird. Many said, please take the bird for free because I can't even afford to feed them any longer. So when we come across fear thrown at us constantly, what tends to happen is we go into what you might define as irrational behavior. And this irrational behavior is evident in many ways. When you look at the stock market today, you know, we are seeing economies declining by close to 20% in quarter one. Yet on the other hand, stock markets seem to be, you know, aspiring to reach their best. Of course, they're not anywhere close to what they were in March, but certainly they're not far below what they were in March. When we actually, you know, when we think of our own behaviors, and think of our own behaviors in terms of how we are behaving. You know, our days are becoming a blur. We actually move mindlessly from one day to the other. Our life is getting dominated by screens. We're watching things, you know, through webinars. We're having conference calls. We're watching streaming movies, entertainment, etc. We're not going out anywhere. We're not meeting anyone. We are fearful. We're obsessively cleaning things around us. Even if, let's say, delivery boy comes in and keeps something and delivers something to us, we dutifully keep it on the side, we spray it with the sanitizer, leave it for an hour, assume that everything is clean before we actually even touch it. Even if you look at our dress code today, we are forever dressed in our night clothes, or even less. We, you know, many of us think that, you know, it's better that we sport shaggy beards and unkempt hair. So have we been reduced to all of this? And this is, and would we have described ourselves like this maybe 6 months back? Certainly not. It's purely because of the fear of the unknown that we're even fearing to step up. So when things go back to normal, and I'm hoping that, you know, at some stage we will all go back to normal and we will do things the way we were used to doing things, will we go back to our normal behavior? Is the first question that we should ask us. Or will we stay with some of these newly formed habits which have become addictive? Will we actually go into a theater? Or will we actually prefer to watch entertainment on Netflix or on, you know, Prime Video or something like that? Will we continue to want to work from home? Or would we be comfortable going into an office? Would we want to eat out in a restaurant? Or would we continue to prefer to cook at home? Would we, you know, want to go back to a store and buy, or would we continue to buy online? Would we prefer the comfort of going somewhere close by, like a local grocer, buy more hyperlocal, or would we want to go travel distances to go to a hypermarket? Look at the consumer conveniences that, you know, we are now seeking. And that's purely because of the fact that all of us have been driven into having to do work at home. A lot of the men I know certainly have actually for the first time done what is known as this Bartan Jadu Pochna or BJP, which is actually the, you know, first time I've actually started scrubbing things around, cleaning a bathroom, cleaning the floor. And we're now beginning to feel that, you know, all these, there are instruments for this. And why don't we actually look at these instruments? Self-reliance. We all lived without domestic help for the first 1 to 2 months. And we figured out that we still managed without domestic help. We're living with a wardrobe which is very different from what it used to be in the past. And we continue to look at a wardrobe. So the first time online retail opened up and offline retail opened up, the first run was for things like athleisure products, you know, track pants, t-shirts, loungewear. We normally have either office wear or we have nightwear. So we actually discovered that there is a need to be in the house for a longer term, and hence we looked for something called loungewear. We manage more simply than the more complicated ways that we managed in the past. Virtual meetings made us question, should we have actually traveled so much in the past? You know, we got used to not celebrating. We got used to not going out. So if you look at it from the alcohol suppliers, what they're saying is we are selling spirits, but our sales of wines and champagnes have actually crashed. So every single behavior of ours actually has an implication in terms of how retail consumption has. Look at, you know, what we think of it from transportation. And we are thinking of it from, you know, we all wanting now to look at non-personal transportation. If you go to buy a bicycle today, it actually is in short supply. And bicycle stocks are not going to be coming in till October. If you look at a two-wheeler, some of the best months that we've had last year, last month, June and July, were better months for the two-wheeler industry than even last year, purely because people are beginning to think of personal transportation as opposed to public transportation. Now, the thing that we need to reflect on, and when you ask me this question, will retail be the same, is wouldn't retail have changed a little bit because of all of this? We don't know the future. We don't know how these behavioral trends will actually persist. But we need to make sure that if they change, and we believe that it'll change, and some of these habits will remain with consumers, if it does change, and then do we want to be left behind by not having changed with those trends? And if we persist by continuing to do the things that we used to do in the past and believe that this change is purely temporary, then certainly we'll be left behind. And that is why I'm saying that the future is still unknown. But while the future is unknown, what we need to know is that how we prepare for a changed future, how we make sure that we are actually going to be able to adapt to the changed consumer of the future in whichever manner we think about it, that is actually going to spell the difference between a successful retailer and an unsuccessful retailer. And which is why we should all grab this opportunity with both hands to make sure that we change. And if we don't change, then we certainly have a problem. I hope that is, I know it's a long answer for a short question, but I needed to be able to give you the context to set it.
Well, you covered a range of things about the, from the consumer's point of view. Now let's come to the business side now. You know, it is predicted, a lot of studies are saying 30-35% people in the retail industry will never come back to their jobs, you know, especially the front-end staff. A lot of, as the format, as the model, habits will change, model will change, and the real estate will shrink, real estate occupied by retail. So do you think, I mean, will that be a permanent thing, or will that be replaced by technology, you know, use of technology? Like, you know, I mean, let's look at the business side now. Yes, of course, the things will change, but will it be an opportunity for technology to take place?
When you ask me that, I think the biggest driver of this change will be technology. I just want to dwell on just two channels. One is what you call as the contact centers, and look at a contact center today. In the past, a contact center lived on call volumes. Call volumes determined number of employees. Number of employees determined office spaces. Today, when you look at contact centers, a lot of contact centers are actually getting replaced by technology. Not entirely, but parts of it. So when you think of a contact center today, and if you look at the engagement, you know, you have chats, you have bots, you have ways in which you can actually, you have IVR. So there is a way of being able to use technology to guide the consumer through some initial process. What has happened at the end of it? At the end of it is that a part of the capacity which is earlier physically manned is today getting replaced by technology. That's all that we are doing. So what happens? The number of people required in a contact center actually reduces. What happens because of that? Sometimes you're able to figure out that you're able to scale using technology rather than scale using people. Now, that is the reality also, let's say, for example, in the IT industry. They're also beginning to feel that use of digital products, use of automation within their own processes is able to help them scale without adding people the way they used to do so in the past. Now, think of it from a retailer's perspective. And a retailer, if you were to look at it at a store level, think of what used to happen in the past. In the past, and we know that, you know, 90% of our retail, or maybe 88% of our retail, is still traditional, the single store-owned mom-and-pop retailers, traditional retailers. A lot of the traditional retailers are small stores, you know, 700 max 1,000 square feet, keep maybe about 1,000 SKUs. Most of them are in the grocery business, and they're close to your homes. What would they do in the past? Normally, and even into the current also, there are a lot of people who do the same thing, which is they, when you actually ask for something, they pick what is there behind on the shelf, which is behind them, pick it up and give it to you. Then they write something on a small slip of paper and give it to you. And that is the amount that you need to pay. You pay cash normally, you pay less on credit card in those kind of stores. And then you take your goods and go away. What is the first change that happened with them? The first change that happened with a lot of them is that they said that it's becoming difficult for us to do so because, first of all, we don't even know what we have in our stores if we keep doing this. Because how was inventory managed? Inventory was actually managed by the mind, by remembering what needed to be bought and what, you know, needed and what quantity had to be bought at that. And that meant that it was very, very person dependent, which is that the traditional shopkeeper couldn't move out of a store, because if he moved out of a store, nobody else knew how to run that store. And the people who actually were in the store were largely part of the family and trusted people like, you know, a nephew, niece or somebody else like that, because there was a lot of cash to use. So when they transformed and they started actually moving towards computerized billing, creating a small little slip which comes out of a cash machine, being able to capture some of the inventory on their computers, then they actually moved to the next level, which is being able to track my daily sales. Daily sales by amount, daily sales by product. They began to move to the next level in terms of inventory management as opposed to replenishing inventory. They actually began to then understand clearly that maybe there is some potential in capturing the telephone number at least of the customer who's coming in so that I can have a conversation with that particular customer. So, you know, people have been progressing. And what you're actually seeing is that retailers are getting enabled by technology. in this period of time, a lot of the retailers realized that they couldn't even access the companies which used to supply them. They had to actually go online because even transport limitations did not allow them to be able to buy by physically going to a mandi or physically going to a wholesale market, because the market is closed, so they didn't have vehicles to be able to go there, or they didn't have a pass which could allow them to go there. So a lot of them realized that, you know, even as a retailer, it made sense for me to buy from a B2B marketplace, like say a Metro or an Udaan, or even from a Big Baskets marketplace area. So these were some of the changes that happened during this period of time. And I think retailers have also begun to realize, even the smallest of them have begun to realize, that you need to be able to actually use technology to enable yourself. If you want to maintain your connect, earlier you were just happy with people walking to your store, buying from you and going away. You didn't even know them other than by face. So because they repetitively come to your store, you knew clearly who they were. Some of the more, let's say the older retailers, even began to know the family of the customer who used to come to their place. So that is how they used to do. But now they've realized that they actually need to be able to capture some customer detail. They have to maintain a relationship with customers. They are not the only ones who can supply to a customer. You can get somebody else to supply to a customer. So if your business is under threat, and if you think technology is going to be an enabler of your business, why would you want to hesitate in actually being able to do that? One, because of the fear of technology, or two, because of the cost of technology. But what we are seeing is several programs that several of the market players are doing, which is including the JioMart program, they are able to actually access technology in a sensible manner, which will enable their operations and at a cost which is insignificant compared to what they might have had to do in the past. A lot of retailers need today.
I have been for the last 5-6 years, I have been talking about technology in terms of, you know, better customer engagement, loyalty programs to be changed, and, you know, whole reward models to be changed completely, you know, AI, artificial intelligence in terms of customer engagement. And every time I spoke to brands and they said, yeah, it's a great idea, we'll do it. And they were not really taking it seriously. And I guess there were must be many reasons, or, you know, partly CIOs are busy with their day-to-day firefighting. So do you think those things will happen now because it becomes a necessity, not something good to have, but our time has come, or still they can get away with those things?
Well, I think a lot of companies have realized, retail companies have realized, that you have to be able to transform yourself in case you want to remain relevant in the new generation. When I'm talking about new generation, I'm talking about both new generation of retail as well as new generation of customers. So what they've realized is that access to a product is not just merely physical. Today, just because I have a store and I'm close to where the customer is, it doesn't mean that the customer will come to me to buy. So they've realized that there are other ways in which customers can actually buy, which is the first realization is online. Maybe about 10 years back, that customers can actually buy online and not buy from a store. The second part of it is they said that if an online player who has no previous experience in retail, no previous domain knowledge in category, is able to come in and make themselves successful, and more importantly, make themselves more valuable in terms of actually, you know, what they're able to, you know, derive in terms of corporate value, then why is it that I, who have actually done this for so many years, cannot do the same thing? So a lot of them have begun to see that the other side of the fence is probably greener than the side of the fence that they are on. So they've also begun to get transformed. Now, of course, any change is, you know, anybody who has been doing things in a certain manner normally tends to lapse into lethargy. And they say that, hey, it's worked for us. You know, why do we need to change? We can continue to do it the same way. Whatever little changes you want me to make, I will do some small modifications to be able to accommodate some of those changes that you want to make. Pandemic came, and then business closed 100% on Monday. When that happened, they realized that, oh, hell, now I've got to be able to figure out how to keep the revenue registers ringing. And how can I do that? I cannot do that because though I'm in the essentials category, I can't source because my suppliers aren't ready, and I can't sell my customers are not coming into my store. So a lot initially who are in the essential category immediately decide to morph to becoming online players in their local neighborhood at least. So their first stage of online was, can I at least get the telephone numbers of my customers and call them up and ask them what do they want? So if they're calling to me, then at least I can, you know, deliver to their homes. Can I create a small little website? And there are many companies and startups here which actually help a traditional retailer to be able to get at least online to a basic extent. So can I create a small little website? Can I create a product catalog? Can I create a payment gateway? Can I create a mechanism which actually, you know, keeps it, makes my inventory transparent so that I at least know what the customer can buy from me and what I need to buy from my supplier? So there are small ways in which retailers have actually started to move towards it. But once the pandemic came in, then they've all started accelerating these changes because they realized that that's the only way to do business. There is no other way you can do business. And if there is no other way you can do business, then you might as well do this. Having done this and having tasted success to a large extent in having done this, then a lot of people are saying that, oh heck, why the hell didn't I actually start doing this in the past? Why have I taken so long to be able to do? So the traditional decision-making process, the traditional power centers which used to influence digital transformation, like say the IT departments, etc., a lot of them lost out because the business team started getting involved in actually driving technology, saying that this is what the customer wants and this is the marketplace and these are the constraints that I'm operating with. And in that context, we have to continue running this business. And because earlier, doing something digitally was actually like a small add-on to an existing business. Now, if the business, entire business is actually confined to digital, then obviously there is no other way you're going to be able to pay your salaries if you don't actually adopt it fast. And that is what has actually provoked a lot of retailers into doing so. Now, retail, and I'm just dwelling on this purely because if you ask me things about AI and, you know, some of the other technologies that have actually come in. And retailers have actually, you know, even when you were doing the manual bill, as I described to you earlier, when you were actually looking at an inventory on the shelf and deciding whether it ran out because you don't see it on the shelf any longer. The pharmacy retailers are notorious for this. If you go to a pharmacy with a prescription, they will actually tell you that, hey, we've run out of this particular item. So they'll tell you that we can't supply. They'll tell you that this is a substitute medicine which is available. They'll promptly write the item that you had asked for in a notebook. Okay? Because that notebook is actually what they have to use to be able to replenish their stocks from the distributor. So even the Kirana retailer was pretty much following the same principle. Only thing is, instead of the notebook, it used to always be in the mind of the shopkeeper. So that when he goes to the wholesale market, he knows what to buy and bring back to the store. Now, you know, with actually getting to computerized billing, with actually getting into inventorized, you know, computerized inventory management, what they're actually beginning to see is that there is data available. You know, I'm actually generating data from all these customers. I'm getting customer data. I'm getting product sales data. A lot of this stuff is currently coming, but I don't know what to do with it. So slowly, some of the more progressive ones amongst them are saying that, hey, there's a lot of data which I can actually do something with. So they've all started then, of course, starting to, you know, you're familiar with this whole thing of creating data lakes, because they realize that, you know, the POS system was one system. The inventory was in another system. The company accounts was on maybe some ERP system. So they figured out that, you know, it is difficult to be able to knit all this data together. So they've now begun to start figuring out how to knit data together to be able to create data pools and data lakes. And if the data pools and data lakes is now being able to create rich data out of that. From the rich data, they go to the next step, which is at least, can I use this for my analysis? Yeah. So that's this whole science of data analytics is coming. From that, they've gone on to say that, hey, if there are sustainable patterns, can I create some intelligence out of it? So then we got on to artificial intelligence, things which are done repetitively. They say, can we do some machine learning out of this? So what is now beginning to happen is that retailers, and especially the more progressive ones, have realized that there was a gold mine that they were sitting on. And they were doing nothing with that gold mine. Now they have begun actually looking at that gold mine and saying that, how do I extract value out of this gold mine that I'm sitting on? And then, you know, how do I make sure that I work in terms of transformation? And then, you know, try and do this and then force the people who were actually forecasting to now work on replenishment. If earlier, if you were in the fashion business, you made a guess in the month of April, stating that this is the quantity that I will order of these designs for the month of August. And if you were actually making, you know, designing some of those products yourself, you actually guessed in the previous year, in October of 2019, that this is what I want in September of 2020. Mm. Okay. So the lead times were huge. And you were actually guessing what designs will sell. And then later on, you were guessing what quantities of those designs will sell. And then at the end of it, you're waiting for 6 months to happen and for these designs to move into stores before you understood even what customers were buying. And once mm-hmm. customers started buying, you were stuck because they were buying some things and you were running out of stock of those, and they were not buying some things and you were sitting with obsolete stock of those. And then you are immediately lapsing into a discount cycle and saying, this is my end of season sale. I want to clear the stuff that customers did not buy. But now the smarter ones are figuring out that, you know, it is impossible to be able to guess a customer so much in advance of the buying period. So is there a way in which I can actually guess faster to the buying period, which means that can I use digital transformation to be able to even transform just the entire design and forecasting cycle? Can I transform even simple things like, say, the manufacturing cycle? I mean, I maybe take a minute to dwell on some simple things in fashion manufacturing. So I make a design, and then I actually, as a designer, think of this as, say, midnight blue, okay? And then I give a color code to it, which is part of, let's say, the color book. And then, you know, the color code gets translated back again to the manufacturer. And he looks at midnight blue, and this is my color code for midnight blue. And what he does is he starts with cotton, and he then uses a color which kind of generally thinks which will match it. Okay, because obviously with different colors on different fabrics, the color translation is also going to be different. So he looks at something which he thinks will match midnight blue. Then he sends that physically back again to the manufacturer, to the brand. And then the brand looks at it and says, it's not this shade of midnight blue, I want another shade of midnight blue. And this whole process starts all over again. Now, just a simple digital transformation of actually translating the color from the desk of the designer to the desk of the supplier, and the digital transformation of that in terms of checking the color when he's actually dyeing it, and then understanding whether this is working or not, has actually managed to cut that entire cycle by something between 45 to 60 days. Okay. And this is in a 4-month product development process. Half the time is gone in garments going up and down to be able to match colors. So what I'm saying is that there are simple ways in which digital has actually helped to transform processes and reduce the time taken for a process, such that it makes it easier for you to be able to guess closer to when the customer is buying. The second part of it is in terms of, let's say, ordering the entire quantity just before the season. And many times people have realized that, you know, why should I take such a large quantity and then be stuck with either stockouts or excess? So they've said, let's order smaller quantities and we can keep replenishing these quantities as the season goes through. So even being able to move away from this once in 6 month purchase to buying what you call as maybe 12 drops in a year, 24 drops in a year, so that every 2 weeks they're actually bringing in new merchandise, they're able to react fast to the new merchandise that is being, you know, whether it's selling or not selling, and you're able to react in terms of supplies. All of that has been enabled by digital. So what I'm saying is that the progressive retailers, once they understand and appreciate the full suite of digital transformation technologies which are available, both in their interaction with customers, as well as their own internal processes, as well as in their interaction with suppliers, they are the ones who are certainly going to be able to harvest the benefit of digital transformation and then get better and more successful than those who actually stayed behind. So that's, you know, it's a long answer to that question. Yeah. But so I think basically that's what it is.
We're getting a lot of interesting questions on the. So I think, you know, we need to quickly run now because I would like to really address these questions and we don't have much time left. In fact, there is somebody in audience, which is our common acquaintance, Brendan from London.
Brendan, and, a good old friend of mine.
Yeah, he's asking a question, very interesting question. He says in the US, there have been a partnership between Simon Group and the Authentic Brand Group to acquire bankrupt retailers. Do you think something like that can happen in India?
It will. It will. And it will happen because the cash-rich set of people, and you're seeing it also today, you know, cash-rich retailers see this as a great opportunity to be able to acquire those who are struggling. Because you cannot get retail at a better price than what it is today. That is one. Secondly, a lot of mall developers are beginning to see that there are empty spaces in their malls because several of the bankrupt retailers, especially in the US, are actually vacating the mall because they can't afford to keep a store there. So there are empty spaces which are happening in a mall. And if there are empty spaces happening, then either you've got to figure out how to repurpose that space or you've got to figure out how to be able to re-tenant that space. And a lot of people and a lot of mall developers, and especially Simon Group, which is a large mall developer in the United States, in fact, the largest there, have actually realized that this might be a great opportunity to partner. Their business is not retail. Their business is mall development. But they can partner with somebody who's in the brands business, who's also in retail business, and then go around acquiring new retailers and also populate their malls, which are actually getting more and more vacant, and thereby be able to create the same zing that the mall had. So it's a great opportunity at this point of time to be able to do so. Because if you're buying it at let's say, at salvage value, you get it at a very low price. If you're buying it through a distress sale, it's a slightly higher price, but you still get it at a great deal compared to what it might have been maybe a year before.
There is another good, interesting question. I'm getting drawn to these questions. What do you think is the future of franchisee businesses? Because in this, post this, you know, because they have been very quite badly affected because on both sides. But do you think franchise model will last post this or it will, because now on one side D2C is becoming stronger. So will that disappear or will it get consolidated?
Well, there are three things to remember about the franchise business. The first thing is, what are you franchising? Okay, because the strength of the brand will determine the success of the franchisee. The second part of it is that who is the franchisee? Is he somebody who's committed to retail and wants to do it and is going to be able to enable the sale of your brand in that particular location? Is the second part of it. The third is the duration of the relationship. And you have to remember about it from all these three perspectives, because a franchisee makes upfront commitments in terms of space, investments, etc., including the inventory investment. And obviously, he's looking for a long duration. So when you think of it from a brand's perspective, the brand also has to think of it from a long duration of time. Cannot think of it from a short duration of time. So that's the first and the most important tenet of this particular relationship. So during this long relation of time, you will also discover, and assuming that the brand is strong and will continue to remain strong, because if your brand is strong but getting, you know, increasingly weaker, then your franchisee will desert you. If your brand is strong and getting to be increasingly stronger, then you probably need to build more franchisees to be able to sustain your business. So, you know, it works both ways. So during this period of time, which is a long duration, you should expect several ups and downs in the economic cycle. And how you handhold your franchisee during the good times, he will handhold you. And during the bad times, you have to handhold the franchisee. And you have to build this as a bedrock on which there is trust and there is transparency. And unless those two actually determine that, you know, the franchisee relationship cannot be run on the basis of an agreement. It has to be run on the basis of how well you understand his business, how empathetic are you about the challenges that the franchisee is facing, and how willing are you to be able to address those challenges along with the franchisee. So during the last 3 to 4 months, when several franchisees have been closed, there have been examples of companies which have actually stepped up and said, I will at least maintain your fixed cost and at least your employee cost. And my employees are taking a 30% cut. Ask your employees to take 30% cut and I will at least provide you that as a minimum guarantee so that you can actually sustain. So even if you don't have any business, your costs are covered. And many franchisers have actually done that to be able to help their franchisee business to be able to sustain, because they know that this lockdown is challenging for both. It's not just their problem, but it's also their franchise problem. Think of it, I mean, I just like to take the example of that 20,000 crores. Approximately 15,000 crores is actually generated by franchises. Mm. Only 25% of their business franchises is certainly going to be having a lot of problems in the future. So it is depend, you know, you've got to figure out all of these things, risk mitigate, support, trust, transparency. These are some of the relationships, and those which have done it well, franchises have actually survived and also managed to, you know, retain the same respect and trust they have in the company in the as in the month of March.
So let me come back to digital transformation from my origin. We know that, you know, there's a lot of focus on digital transformation towards customer engagement. Do you think retailers will also be ready to now invest money on digital transformation and engaging with the suppliers and partners as well? You know, because see, that's a piece which has been left behind.
Correct. No. So there is, see, if you really think of it, what is engagement? Engagement is the art of being able to discuss, talk with your supplier or with your customer to be addressing common problems. Okay. Because a customer problem is not just their problem, but it's also your problem. So that is what you're trying to do. A lot of what customer engagement we are seeing in the recent past has actually become digital, largely because of the fact that if you look at the Generation Z, I always say, likes to chat instead of talk. Okay. You can actually chat with your fingers, but you talk with your mouth. So they prefer to chat as opposed to talk. Now, there are still customers who want to talk. So when you want customers who want to talk to you, you know, today you're figuring out that, okay, you don't seem to understand conversation. But there are technologies such as, say, natural language programming, etc., which has enabled you to be able to understand what the customer is speaking. Okay, and then do that in not just one language, but in many languages, which enables you to be able to give you a machine answer to what a customer in Z, which actually might be chatting with you. And when they chat with you in whether it's English or any of the local Indian languages, what you're seeing is that you're able to actually provide an answer based on, you know, a whole bunch of heuristics that you work in the background with in saying what's the most likely answer for this kind of a question. They're actually able to lead you down a series of choices which enable you to be able to pinpoint the specific query that you have. So when you look at, say, for example, the telecom providers, okay, the telecom providers, the financial service companies, etc., a lot of them have actually managed to move a large part of their conversation to a more predefined form. And that predefined form could not have happened without technology. So whether it's chats, whether it's bots, even internally, today you have bots which allow people to be inducted into a company without even having a physical interface. So a bot will actually meet you, greet you, give you an employee number, will actually help to, you know, induct you into the company, will actually give you the rule books of the company, the procedures that you have to follow in different things, and guide you along an induction program, which might be 2 weeks to a month, without having a physical entity or a person actually speak to you. Bots can today work in terms of being able to interact with your outside suppliers, can interact with your customers. If you're a B2B customer and you're inquiring about suppliers when things will be available, today bots are able to do a lot of that stuff. Bots are used in sales. You know, they're used to be able to guide salespeople in terms of even understanding what's my customer outstanding from this particular customer that I'm going to be able to visit. What is it that they bought in the past? How much should I pitch for at this point of time? The same technology is actually today translating also to suppliers. And suppliers have actually been a little more primitive in terms of adopting this, because while the company makes investments internally and also enables its own field force externally, employees in field force externally, and sometimes even their associates of the company, which could be a franchisee or could be a distributor, etc., enables them digitally. Many a time they don't enable the suppliers. And today what you're seeing is that even suppliers are willing to move up, because a lot of technology today is not just about making capital investments. It's about making slight modifications in your operating system and working on a SaaS basis. And when that is happening, it then makes it easier for you to be able to adopt technology in a relatively less expensive manner and to be able to progress with technology as technology keeps changing. And a lot of companies are now beginning to realize that this touchless, contactless world that we are currently going through is not just for our customers, but also for our suppliers. And our suppliers also want touchless and contactless environments to work with. So they're also wanting to be able to transact with you in the same way that you are transacting with your customers. So I'm saying that customer engagement is just one way in which technology enables us. And when we think of it from that perspective, the same technology should enable our interactions also with our suppliers.
We have three questions now. We need to cover in the next 10 minutes. One is about the buying behaviors, change in buying behaviors. Traditionally, this was being done with the historic data, customer data. And with these, in the last 5-6 months, the behavior has changed. Historic data has no relevance now anymore. Do you think that the new models for demand forecasting and the assortment planning will come in place, and that's where the new technology will come in a very greater role? And it's a similar question asked by one of our audience members, is Rakesh Sinha, Dr. Rakesh Sinha as well. So
two parts to it, yeah. So I understand where they're coming in from. So we have to remember that in times of change, the quality of your data actually suffers. Okay, if you've got sustained data which is following a predictable pattern, then you're able to make some meaningful analysis of this data, because you've got, let's say, 12 months of data in a certain category, and there have been some trends which have been, you know, not very significant. So when you've got sustained data of that nature, then for you to be able to use it to make a forecast makes it a lot easier. But during the last 5 months, if you look at what data you have, at least data for the time that you've managed to keep your stores open, that data is very, very choppy data, because there is nothing available in the data which will actually reveal a pattern. So what you can only do is use the data for the purposes of understanding what are customers doing. Use the understanding of what customers are doing to be able to say that this is what I should do based on what customers are doing. And then I keep an eye out to see if customers are actually changing over time, even in what they're doing. So between August and September, has there been a difference in how they are behaving? Between September and October, is there a difference in how they're behaving? How quickly can I actually react to those changes in behavior, as opposed to making a foolhardy forecast and saying that this is what I think they will buy in the month of October? So I keep saying now that forget all your annual forecasts. Forget even your monthly forecast. Live week to week. Understand what the week has actually revealed to you. Use that understanding to plan for the next week. Sometimes you might need a longer horizon than a week, because you don't have, you know, you can't react in a week itself for some things. So you might need to take a longer horizon. That's where you make a little bit of a bet. But you would be foolhardy to make a bet for 6 months in today's scenario. That is clear. Because neither do we have the understanding, nor we have the data which will allow us to be able to do something like that. Just to share with you, maybe a couple of examples, just quickly. When retail opened up, okay, when stores began to open up, on an average, retailers are doing anywhere between 25 to 35%. Now, we might think of that being the demand which is being expressed. However, if you look at that 25 to 35%, look at a category like grocery or pharmacy, it was as high as 85% of normal. Look at a category such as electronics. It was as high on an average as 70% of normal. But then within that 70%, laptops, iPads, dongles, and other such accessories which enable work from home was actually 130% of normal. I mentioned to you about bicycles. Look at wedding wear. That's hotel business. Most people are working at within single digits in terms of hotel occupancies. So you can see this wide variance, even in terms of, even if you look at apparel per se, which is about 30%, loungewear at leisure is at 65% versus, let's say, occasion wear, which is at 15%. So you have to be able to dissect data at a degree of detail which will enable you to make meaningful understanding out of the data. And the second part of it is you've got to figure out how you want to react to it, because what you're seeing today might not actually happen tomorrow.
Right.
You have to be able to figure out how to react fast as that keeps changing. So I would be, you know, to give you a single line answer to that long explanation, I would be thinking it would be foolhardy to hazard a guess in terms of forecasting today.
I've got two more very related questions, one from Simon from London and one from Kunal Raymond. Why do you think retailers were reluctant to invest money in technology till now? And Kunal is asking, why do you think they have money? Because on one side, they're cash trapped. Do you have money to do all these things which are required at this point of time?
So you've got to see it, so let me address both of them together, because I think they're both related questions.
Yeah.
The first part of it is that retailers have been reluctant largely because they've been comfortable. And this comfort, they've now got out of their comfort zones. Humans, all of us as consumers, have got out of our comfort zones. Okay, in terms of our own behavior, look at how we are behaving in the house. Look at how we are behaving outside of our house. We're actually putting in significant filters in terms of how our behavior is. We are doing things in the house which we never did in the past, and we are not doing things outside which we used to do in the past. So all of us are actually changing. And similarly, corporations are also beginning to realize that the things have changed so much around them that they have to uproot themselves of the behavior that they used to do in the past. The more cash-rich retailers have actually found it comfortable to be able to adopt technology faster. The cash-starved retailer finds it difficult to adopt technology today. But what everybody has at least certainly understood, technology is a great enabler in today's business environment. So the only way they can actually make sure that they're going to be successful in the future is by being able to adopt this technology as fast as possible. Luckily today, technology is no longer like it used to be in the past, where it meant capex heavy. You know, so if you wanted to invest in something, you had to invest in the software, you had to invest in the hardware, then you had to invest in all the programs which went around it. And then you had to invest in an exercise which actually took you 4 to 6 months to be able to even adapt it to your organization's requirement. Today, technology, because of agile systems, is able to be adopted much faster. Technology is no longer a capex item. Technology is a revenue item. You don't have to worry about servers because everything is today on the cloud. A lot of technology is actually moving down to mobiles, so because of which you don't even need to invest in the front end, because even your consumer or your own sales force and your own employees outside also have mobile, and they're able to adopt it through the app system or through any other system. So what I'm seeing today is that it doesn't require the same. You need to have the motivation too. You need to have the understanding of what it'll do to you, because sometimes also in this kind of an environment, you end up by going around and buying a lot of useless technology too. So buy what is important for the core, to be able to protect your core, what will enable your front end. Then maybe the next thing that you should do is to look at what will probably enable your internal processes, and lastly, what will enable your suppliers. So look at technology even in that phased manner in terms of investments. Look at technology from a SaaS perspective. Look at being able to host in the cloud. Things will be a lot cheaper than what we used to do it in the past.
So Biju, finally, because we are a startup platform, both TAI and 100 Watts, finally, last question. What do you think is the role of startups in this new scenario of post-pandemic for retail industry?
So every startup should question two things. One is, do I have the cash to survive this pandemic? Mm-hmm. Okay, because startups often trade with negative EBITDAs. So if your EBITDA is negative, it means that you have to figure out how to cut your costs. That's the one important thing, because whatever be the opportunities that this pandemic throws to you, if you're not there around to survive, if you're not going to be surviving this thing, you're not going to be around to be able to see those opportunities, then you have a separate problem. So the first thing I would all advise any startup today is don't behave like the way you behaved in the past. Remember that funding is finite. Your investors will ask you tomorrow that when are you going to get to profitability as opposed to when are you going to get to revenue. So think of profitability as opposed to thinking of revenue. And the third thing is, remember that you have to be able to craft an organization. So while you had many people who started along with you, but you might have to take some painful decisions about resizing organizations to be able to meet the needs of tomorrow. That's one part of it. Second is, what are the needs of tomorrow? The needs of tomorrow are customer problems. So don't chase things which are technology, which is independent of customer problems. Think of it from a customer problem perspective. Think of where customers are today. And in that context, what is it that I can actually find as a solution for them? So I've seen a lot of technologies today which talk about being able to neutralize the COVID virus. We all saw that, you know, sanitizers went through the roof in terms of sales. We also saw masks went through the roof in terms of sales. Now, these are opportunities which are there, certainly for the immediate. How long will they exist? I'm not so sure. But I'm not suggesting you make sanitizers and masks. But what I'm suggesting is that look at technologies which will enable your customers in the lifestyle that they are currently leading today, such that they find you relevant in the future. That's the way I would see it. But remember, you have to craft yourself and create and curate your own business model to last till you see those opportunities.
Thank you, Biju. It was very wonderful. And I think we just made it in time and we really packed it very well. Thanks for, you know, packing in so much of information and so much of insights in such a short time. And thank you, Ty, for organizing this, for helping us to organize this. And thanks a lot for all those who attended. And I hope you enjoyed the session and you found it valuable. And thanks. And once again, good wishes for Ganesh Chaturthi.
Thank you. Thank you, Ajay and Tripti. And best wishes to everybody.
Thank you, Bijoy. Thank you, Ajay. Looking forward to hosting Bijoy again sometime soon. And we did mention the coming up webinar in the chat box, so do have a look at it. And obviously, the video will be coming in the next 2 to 3 days. So we'll have it sent across over an email. So in case if you have missed any of the pointers or great insights, you can just watch it again. Thank you, guys. Have a wonderful weekend.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.